We can now say that human beings have flown a rotorcraft on another planet.
That's Mimi Aung. She's a NASA engineer and currently the project manager for the Mars Ingenuity, the mini helicopter that's been charming all of us Earthlings.
Hi, my name is Mimi Aung. I'm the project manager for Ingenuity Mars Helicopter. My team and I just flew the first ever rotorcraft flight on another planet. I no longer have to say this is our goal. Oh, I get to change my script.
It's being called a Wright Brothers moment, the first controlled flight by an aircraft on another planet. NASA's 4-foot-wide Ingenuity helicopter has now successfully flown 3 times in Mars' rarefied atmosphere. Just this weekend, her little helicopter that could achieved its fastest and furthest flight yet, streaming loads of data and imagery down to the Jet Propulsion Lab, or JPL, in Pasadena, California.
Spinning its blades 10 times faster than an earthly helicopter, Ingenuity cut through thin Martian air today on a brief but historic flight. 30-year NASA vet Mimi Aung is the lead engineer. It took her team 6 years to nail the technology to make this first-of-its-kind flight possible.
Like a Wright Brothers moment, but on another planet.
Talk to me about what this really means. It's not just a helicopter flight. Like, how different does a helicopter on Mars have to be from flying one on Earth? And what does that mean?
Yeah, absolutely. This is game changing in terms of starting with what it means is we are not using the aerial dimension for space exploration today. You know, we have spacecraft orbiting planets and we have rovers roving on the surface, right? The area dimension that we're not using is the aerial dimension. So on Earth, we have trains and cars on the ground and spacecraft in orbit, but we also have planes and helicopters flying, right? So we're not doing that at Mars or any of the planetary targets that we explore today. So super game-changing to be able to fly, you know, with the rotorcraft, and it will add to that space exploration toolkit.
Mimi's been excited about space for a long time. She joined the JPL in 1990 and has worked in projects related to spaceflight and the NASA Deep Space Network ever since, a career she's fought hard for.
It wasn't obvious to me that I had a path to space exploration. While I was fascinated with space, right? Like, what's out there? You know, is there life out there? Are we alone? I mean, that's something I didn't think I would ever get an opportunity to, be a part of it. I received a lot of those comments, right? Why do you want to study that? Wouldn't you rather go into something that's more, you know, amenable for girls at the time, right?
Lucky for Mimi, she had a woman in her own home who set exactly the right example for girls.
Since young, I was inspired by my mother, who has always been very technical. She's a PhD in math. She's very practical, and I learned early from her the importance of logic.
Aung was born in the U.S., but grew up in Burma, inspired by her mother, who got her PhD in math in the 1960s.
I think she was the first Burmese woman mathematics PhD from an American university.
Your mother, the pathfinder, and then you are a trailblazer.
Absolutely, yes. I feel very fortunate.
Did it strike you growing up, like how cool your mom was as a woman to be in that field? Especially since today we're still talking about this deficit of women in STEM fields.
It didn't really hit me until now, and especially after now that she's gone.
I've benefited from cultures across the world, and I benefited from just the general Burmese culture. You know, having grown up in a culture of my own, values of respect, the value of being humble. I really do believe that that has benefited me now at the career level.
When you are making a first of a kind capability happen, right, with the team, you run into challenges, right? Going back to what I grew up with, you know, inspired by my mom's always sure-footed, right, based on logic and equations, that's what you really go back to lean on when you face difficult challenges. role of women in space exploration should be equal, you know, men and women, and basically jointly answering the big questions together in space exploration.
From day one, this was the unwavering dream of our team, to get our helicopter launched to Mars so that we can get the opportunity to do that very first rotorcraft flight test in the actual environment of Mars.
This is the first powered and controlled flight we've ever completed on another planet, and NASA had to overcome some pretty impossible odds to do it. In fact, there was a chance this flight might not have happened at all.
Well, the atmosphere at Mars is very thin. It's less than 1% compared to Earth. It's very difficult to fly in very thin air. That's the very first challenge. So the helicopter that we fly has to be very light. We have to weigh less than 2 kilograms.
So the first and foremost challenge is to make a vehicle that's light enough to be lifted. And then the second is to generate lift. The rotor system has to spin very fast.
2,000, 2,200, 2,400. 2600.
We're spinning between 2,000 and 3,000 revolutions per minute, and it takes a lot of energy. So it's that balance of a very light system, yet having enough energy that's needed to, you know, spin the rotor so fast to lift, and on top of it, having to design in the autonomy.
So the top is the solar panel. The mid part is the rotor system with a pair of counter-rotating blades.
So going on to the model here of our solution, okay, there is a solar panel that will garner solar energy from the sun. There is an antenna for wireless communication. It has a rotor system. Ingenuity has a 1.2 meter diameter rotor system, 2 pairs of counter-rotating blades. They'll spin about 2,400 revolutions per minute. And under here is a fuselage that contains a battery that will store the energy gathered by the solar cells. And the fuselage is also equipped with onboard sensors, so cameras, accelerometer, gyros, inclinometer, and an altimeter. And then the vehicle has the landing gear. The entire vehicle that you see here weighs in just under 1.8 kilogram. It's just about 4 pounds.
To get to this point, Ingenuity had to survive a 7-month journey through space, followed by 7 minutes of terror as its rover descended to the Martian surface. Perseverance had to blast off the helicopter's protective shield and gently place it on the rocky surface of Mars. The helicopter had to survive its first sub-zero night, charge up its batteries by itself using its solar panels, and then spin up its rotor blades for the first time to make sure they actually worked on Mars. And despite a couple of technical difficulties, it passed with flying colors.
Our team has been extremely happy and proud of the Ingenuity's flight to date. And now it's like Ingenuity is graduating from the tech demo phase to now the new ops demo phase, where we can show the how a rotorcraft can be used and show products that only an aerial platform from an aerial dimension can give.
I got quite emotional the other day. I actually started crying. I got this sense of our little 4-pound Ingenuity just having a time of its life, and it was hovering the way we like have been designing it to and testing. And it was just like up, hovering, coming down, landing. And I'm like, it doesn't miss us at all.
There's going to be a lot of kids and a lot of girls who will probably be surprised to see a woman is leading this operation. What's your message to them?
You have to go for it and don't second guess. Don't let anybody talk you out of it.
If you're attracted to it, go for it. Don't let anybody talk you out of it, including yourself. So I like to say, find an intersection of what you like to do, what you're good at, and the cause that you want to, you know, make and improve on. Find that intersection of those three. When you find it, like it sounds like you are attracted to STEM, go for it. And it takes tons of hard work, but it won't feel like hard work because you're going to enjoy it so much. Your passion's going to come out of it, and you will be able to make whatever you want to make happen. So yes, my biggest advice, don't let yourself talk you out of it, and definitely don't let other people talk you out of it.
I don't want other kiss the next generation to take as long as I did to realize that, you know, it's okay, you know, there is no such thing as you're not good enough.
For Aung, Mars is just the beginning. When it comes to her future goals, think infinity and beyond.
Give me one that might blow my mind.
A fully autonomous spacecraft, okay, that you just launch and you just say, launch and go find water on another planet. Just on your own, go explore, and then you just write back to us how it's going.
You know, when you find what you want to do, you know, I really like to say find an intersection of what you're good at, what you like to do, and also what you believe in making a change in. Find that intersection, and when you find that, if you put in tons of hard work, you can turn that dream into reality. And don't doubt yourself. Don't let anybody doubt you. When you believe that you can do it, absolutely do it. And along the way, continuously always think critically. You know, really be think critically to really be objective and go for your goals. And nobody can stop you.
Rock on, Mimi.
Mimi Aung, breaking through a glass ceiling nearly 180 million miles away.
Sky's not the limit anymore. Yes, sky's absolutely not the limit.
You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle near your skin. Kept on the inside and no sunlight, sometimes a shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you said.